John B. Wells, welcome to the program.
Thank you very much for having me, sir.
John B. Wells is the host of the daily radio show Caravan to Midnight. John is also an internationally renowned voiceover artist, with credits ranging from serving as the announcer for CBS's The Late Show with Craig Kilborn to announcing promos for hit television shows like Discovery Channel's Deadliest Catch and Gold Rush. John also performed weekend duties as the top-rated host of the nationally syndicated overnight radio show Coast to Coast AM. After frequently serving as a guest host in January 2012, Wells became the Saturday evening host of the most listened-to overnight program in history and held that seat until January 2014. To learn more about John B. Wells, visit caravantomidnight.com. John, you started way back in the day in radio, moved into voiceover and announcing, then back to radio at Coast to Coast AM, and now your own show, Caravan to Midnight. What drew you to radio in the first place? Was there a particular inspiration, or was it simply the fact that you had a voice for radio?
You know, that's a very good question, but the answer is that nothing that I have done over the course of my career was planned by me. I owe everything that I have been able to do to the great one. The only thing that I did was that I just stepped on the stones, the stepping stones that were laid out for me to step onto, and that's what I did. So I never was, I never thought that I would get into radio at all. In fact, my dear departed mother, I was studying the theater, you know. I thought, yeah, acting sounds like a pretty good gig, because I found that, you know, depending on the production, there might be a really good script. I mean, a well-written script, some good language, some large ideas that you could be a part of the storytelling thereof. And so I was working on that, and then one day, my mom asked me to do a spot for her boutique. So I said, yeah, sure, of course. So I went over and recorded it at a little radio station studio. The man who recorded it, or who pushed play and record for me, his wife was one of mom's customers. And so she said, I want my son to do a spot. And so it was all set up. And then, you know, at first it was a little bit of the eye rolling. And I was standing there with this Neumann microphone and a good old workhorse Studer D67 recording deck. And he said, just punch play and record when you're ready. And just there's a counter right there. You can reset it right there. And as soon as you get, you know, don't go up to 1 minute, just 58, 59 seconds, you'll be fine. So I was in there about 5 minutes and said, I think we're good here. And he came in like, okay, let's see what kind of a disaster this is. And he played it. And then he looked at me with this, with this look of, like, abject apology on his face. And he said, I'm going to go get Ted, and I'll be right back. Will you be okay for a minute or two? I went, absolutely. So he went back and got this fellow named Ted Jones, who was the program director for the station. And Ted listened to it and looked at me and looked over at this fellow named John Vacca, who later went on to book me on several projects for General Dynamics, and then what became Lockheed Martin for the defense industry, you know. And Ted put some music on it and all of this stuff and said, you know, you could do this if you wanted to. I said, do what? He said, be a professional voiceover artist. And I thought, okay, well, thanks. And here's a cassette, and thanks. It's nice to meet you. And I went, okay, well, it was nice to meet you, too. Thanks for the cassette. So I'm sitting around with a friend of mine a couple of days later, and I said, hey, you'll get a kick out of this. So I put the cassette into the machine. It was this, actually, we were in a car, and it was this giant Pioneer Super Tuner, this thing with a huge dial on it. They were all the rage back in those days. This was like the late 70s, so. And my friend, Michael Doyle, who passed away at about 04:30 on Thanksgiving Day, just this past, he said, let me have this for a couple of days. I said, what for? He said, I'm going to play this for Mick. Well, the Mick he was referring to is now known as Capitol Hill correspondent Jim Nikolashevsky. And it was going to be great. You know, we would like for you to do all of our spec spots and some of our real spots, and we'll pay you $25 for each one of the spots. And I thought, oh boy, some real money. He said, yes, we'll have between 15, sometimes maybe 20 in a day. Oh boy, some real dough. Nope. They hired me for $1.60 an hour to do the spec spots, the real spots, and in a few months to do their afternoon drive news and take the bag out to the transmitter with all the carts that were going to be loaded in the machines that look like 8-tracks, but they're just one-way mono for an AM station, and the log that started at midnight. Let's say they're a year. And a gal named Gail O'Brien came in and said that Ken Rundle at the Big Rock station, the Zoo in Dallas, KZEW-FM, had an opening for a part-timer, and she needed to use my production room, which wasn't mine, but okay, she can call it mine. She said, and I'll pay you back by letting you know this job is available, and you can apply for it also. Well, she finished at about 3 o'clock in the morning, which is when I started my demo, because they had to be in the next day. So I finished up about 9 in the morning. I was supposed to be there at 10, but I just said, I was just directed to go get in your car and go to Dallas now, because this was in Fort Worth, about 30 miles down the road. So I did, and I handed the tape over, and I got a call a week later. Coincidentally, you know, I was always playing rock and roll music, and I had long hair. I dressed well, but I never, you know, I wasn't a patchouli oil kind of guy, but because I was in the theater after all, so there was a little bit of color there, but, you know, not too much. I don't mean to infer anything I don't intend to, but I'm telling you it was great because, well, you can imagine. Most of the actors were not straight, and all of the women were, so it was a very happy hunting ground for a college-age guy. And so I went over to Dallas, and then the station that I worked at, because of my Bucky attitude and being a rocker in general, they decided that, well, I might not be a good fit for them anymore. So I shook hands, thanked them, and assured them that there'd be no problem with my telling anyone that I worked there, because the last time I mentioned those call letters, a laugh was all I got in response. I said, so that's a safe. The man was shocked. I just shook his hand, said, thank you very much. See you later. And then they put me on from Fridays, from noon until 2, to go over the staff meeting while the entire staff basically slacked off and had a big lunch. And a couple of weeks, they decided to get me to do the 12 to 2 in the afternoon staff meeting, and then come back 12 hours later and do 2 a.m. to 7 a.m. Saturday morning, which was really kind of cool because the only people who were listening were already partied out, so if you made a mistake, there's no problem there. None of the suits were up at that hour. And so I got to, you know, get my chops up. And before long, it was about 3 months, and they put me on 10 to 2 at night. And 6 months after that, they put me in the afternoon drive. And 2 years later, by the grace of the Great One, I achieved a 23.8 share, men 18 to 49. The nearest one was a 13. And, of course, this scared everybody to death and made several people, made the insecurity levels rise in some and just flat out angered some others. And so after that, they thought, well, this guy's dangerous. He's got a little bit too much. He just does what he wants, and we don't like that. We have a direction we want to go, so they let me go. And I'm like, okay, this is great. So I pondered it for a little while. I thought, no, am I going to go back into radio? What am I going to do? Because Q102, the so-called enemy station, was a great station. And for a long time, I thought they were better than the Zoo. Maybe they were, but their power began to fade a little bit, and we got over on them and beat them. That was the only book that I'd ever seen that we'd actually beat Q102. And they'd been asking me to come over, and I just resisted, and I went into full-time voiceovers. And that went on for like 25 years. It was excellent. I got to work on all kinds of projects, just from the sublime to the silly. And then I realized that I no longer needed a studio, no longer needed an engineer, no longer needed an assistant of any kind, no secretary, nothing. I just needed a computer and an internet connection. And I'm sitting there taking the money, which of course is, I'd ask myself, you know, at the end of the day, what have you really accomplished? And I would have to content myself with this answer. You made a living for your family today. That's what you did. Now, shut up and carry on. But it kept nagging at me, like Schwarzenegger in, what was it, Total Recall, where he's up there with his jackhammer. He says, I would just like to do something more meaningful. And I'm thinking, yeah, that's it, Arnie. I want to do something more meaningful. So I went to see my old program director, who had become senior vice president of new content for Premier, and just paid a surprise visit to him, got past all the security with the help of a guy, a producer over there. Just walked right past it all, went right on in. I knocked on his door and went in. And, you know, big handshakes, big hugs, all that stuff. A couple of lunches later, he handed me over to a fellow, and he made a couple of calls, and the next thing I knew, they put me into, I did one show in 2005. Dr. Bruce Lipton and Gabriel Cousins. And then nothing happened after that. 2006, nothing. 2007, nothing. Most of 2008. Ah, I want to say it was either June or October. I don't really remember, but I got to interview. I requested him, and I got him. And that is the legendary, visionary Ray Bradbury himself. Oh, man, this was like being handed an Academy Award that was like 6 feet tall, and you had to have a dolly to roll it out of there because it was made up of solid gold. This was just, it wouldn't have made any difference to me if that had been it. Fini, kaput, that's just to end up. All of it, just, that would have been fine. But it wasn't. Nothing happened in 2009. And then in 2010, I started getting calls from them. I did several shows in 2010, and then a bunch of them in 2011. And then at the end of 11, they said, well, Ian Punnett has ear problems. Would you like to take the Saturday night slot? I said, let me think about it for a second. Okay, I'll do it. And then, so for 2 years, I just thought, yep, this is going to be kind of rough to run a daytime schedule and then go to bed at 5 o'clock Sunday morning because you're a zombie Sunday and you're an even worse zombie on Monday. But I did it for 2 years. So I was on there on deck every weekend for 2 years with the exception of two. And then they decided to go another direction, but not before I had been graced. You know, grace is unearned, unmerited favor. And that's really how I look at this. I mean, maybe I earned it by sitting in the chair. The audience responded to it, but it was a record chair. And in fact, I am not a subscriber to Nielsen, but the figures that I got from people who are subscribers to Nielsen was that sometimes the number of listeners on a Saturday night equaled the entire week. Or surpass it. Well, and then people would call up and they would be very, don't you want to do open lines? It's like, yeah, sure. Well, here came the compliments. And while I was very happy and felt gratified to hear them, I knew this was not helpful. And in some cases, I said, well, thank you very much, but this is not helpful. Because they're saying stuff like, you need to take over the whole show. And I'm like, thank you very much for your call, and we're going to move on now. It was just kind of strange. So they said, okay. And I don't think this is something that they wanted to do. I've always had the sneaking suspicion that the they was with the capital T somewhere else that was telling them, you need to get rid of this guy. He's talking about too much stuff, and he's bringing guests on there to talk about too much stuff. But paradoxically, I mean, I really enjoyed working with those people. I can't think of a single person that I was cross with at any time. I had no contact whatsoever with the main host except about a minute and a half. Let's see, I started, I want to say it was January the 7th, 6th, 5th, 4th. Yeah, I'm thinking the 3rd of January. I spoke with him for about a minute and a half on air, and he welcomed me to the show and all that. And after that, I just got an email every once in a while about, a fellow named Sanders who wrote in the Huffington Post blog was talking about how he missed driving across the desert and listening to the spooky stories Arbel used to have told and tell himself on his program. And it seems to be leaning politically and so forth. And then this generated a little bit of blowback, but I wound up being friends with this guy. And because the next thing he got, I mean, I got this. This is something I've tried to avoid on the show. And that's all the email said. So I ignored it. And then I did another show, and the following weekend, and the email was forwarded to me that Mr. Sanders really liked his show. Really. And after that, it was, hey, can you give him my email address? So I just sent him one back and said, ring me. Here's my phone number. So he called, and we struck up an acquaintance, and he's a great fellow, and a good asset. he knows a lot of people, and he makes me aware of them sometimes, and otherwise I wouldn't be. So just one thing led to another, and that was it. I just it got to the point where I said, look, if you don't want the president's name mentioned, stop booking people on the program who speak his name. I am not a puppeteer. I am not pulling the strings. And I think a guest is entitled to say what they want to, provided they're civil. If you don't want them to say anything, don't bloody well book them, and then they won't say anything. Okay, well, that didn't help either, so I'm out of here. In 2006, I didn't know what I was going to do with caravantomidnight.com, but I purchased that domain in 06. I had no clue what I was going to do with it, but I knew I was going to do something with it. But again, I just didn't know what. So I fired up in, I want to say 2011, maybe 10. And, well, it was 11 because of the Fukushima thing, of course. That's really where it started. I forgot. Yeah, it was March 2011. And I thought, you know, I think I'm going to go out to the mad scientist lab and see if I can find my Geiger counter. There's this giant thing with this big red probe on it. I thought, that's not going to work at the grocery store or anywhere else. Besides, it's from the 70s. So I got a hold of some people who can find really anything that was reasonably priced that people would like to have just to put in their pocket. It was like $800, $900, $1,200, $1,500, $2,000, and up and up and up. And I thought, oh, that's got to be a different way to do this. Well, then some people that we knew in Western Europe contacted some people that they knew in Eastern Europe, and we wound up carrying these things from made by the Russians in this Radex unit, which is pretty good. We haven't had anybody say that it doesn't work anymore as a bad product. But as time went by, the demand became so great, excuse me, my stomach's trying to eat itself, that, you know, there would be little problems like you'd have to really force the batteries in, really push them in there hard. And I said, listen, we cannot handle any, we cannot carry any product that is not of good quality and that causes anybody any difficulty whatsoever. This needs to be a trouble-free experience. I just want to get this product out there. I don't expect to retire on this. And whatever dough we make on this, all we're going to do is buy more product. That's all we're doing. And it was understood we would do that. Diane Comtois and I, she was with Beretta for 10 years. We became friends virtually all those 10 years, but then toward the end, I struck up an acquaintance with a couple of the gun guys over there, shotguns and pistols and such. And I just cruised in there every once in a while just to look at interesting stuff. I very rarely bought anything because it's extraordinarily expensive. Not the pistols, but everything else in there is. And one thing led to another, and we decided to sort of not partner, but work together on this project. And then when I was cut loose in 2014, it was like, okay, let's fire this thing up because there's an agenda afoot here. Somebody would get crazy, and they would call Premier, and they would go all the way up the sales department chain and just give everybody hell. And I thought, you know, there's an easy way to go around this, and that is you don't let your program content be dictated by sponsors. You run the program. If anybody wants to come along, they're welcome to do so. But they're not going to tell us what we can or cannot say. And that's how it is. And I got to tell you, the response was absolutely overwhelming. We were crashing servers. We had everything happen except the computers to the desktops just like catch fire. It was absolutely amazing that this is the greatest audience that a person could ever hope for. They are generous. They contribute to worthy causes. So, many of them just send $100 or $50 or whatever they can. And say, look, we don't really care how you use this. Just use it for something. Give it to a disabled vet who can't afford it in a subscription. Just roll with it and just keep going. So that's what we've done. And we passed our 1-year mark on February 3. And the membership just keeps getting bigger. So anyway, I didn't mean to just go on, but it is kind of a long story, and I was already a talker, and then I got into the talk radio business. Now I can't shut up at all. But I'll pause.
We have an audience question here. What the hell is George Snurry's problem?
Well, my horns are coming out right now. Let me push them back. Put some back into my skull. I'm not sure that he has a problem. other than he wants to protect his gig. You know, it's like Turkey said in the old movie Snatch. Sometimes you're put in a position where you have to do something to compromise your principles. Like, forget you have any. I'm not going to say that he's abandoned his principles, but, you know, I'll either answer your question honestly, or I just won't answer it. But, I think there are a number of things going on there. I think he has pressure from above, and I think he has a duty, with quotes around it, that word, to his sponsors. And you can't blame a guy for trying to protect his job. There are a lot of things out there that aren't meant to be good. They're meant to be bought. And, you know, Mr. Bell got into a lot of trouble for the controversial topics he would discuss. But even Bell drew the line at even entertaining the thought that our government was complicit or culpable in any way with the 9/11 event. So I really don't know what his problem is. As I say, I'm not sure it's a problem. I think he's just very protective of his position and therefore the program. And there are some things he's just not going to do. That means conducting his program the way that he does, and that's how it is. I don't know. That's kind of a general question, isn't it? Not too specific.
I once talked with someone who was a guest on Coast to Coast AM, and they told me that they had to send in their questions first to the producers. They would go over the questions, and they would submit them to George. Is that true?
Mm-hmm. I don't know, but it wouldn't surprise me in the least. I mean, I think that if you listen closely...
Because that means that they... That means, John, that the guests are asking their own questions, not the host.
Well, yes, you're entirely correct. But more than that, I think we have an opportunity to not allow certain questions to be asked. And if I submit a question like, what is so-and-so's problem, that one probably won't make it onto the final list on the guest sheet. You know, I do about 99.9% of my business over some sort of a phone, either headphones or telephone. And you can read people pretty well after a while when you can't see them. And you can read them just by their voice alone. And you can tell when somebody's going down a list of questions and when they're spontaneous. And I detect quite a bit of that in certain interview shows. They just go down the list and then cut them off. And I notice there's a lot of the moment that somebody is going a little bit too deep into something, it'll be like, let's take a call. It's like, yeah, okay, let's interrupt the guy's train of thought and derail that thread real quick. And that's what happens. Yeah, it doesn't surprise me at all.
When you worked for Coast to Coast, did you work from home or did you have to go to their studio?
Well, at first I went to their studio, and I assure you I am the only person who has ever smoked cigarettes in the Clear Channel building. I did it as sort of a perversion. I didn't really even want a cigarette. But then after that, I got a facility that had a lot of people between me and the front door, let's just put it that way, because I just thought it might be the prudent thing to do. So I got a little studio where I could, very very comfortable, it's small, but it's very comfortable, and after the show, I could just close the mic, just power down a little bit, and then immediately walk into the other room and go to sleep. When you run a daytime schedule, I mean, you can't do anything on Saturday or you'll never make it 0400 Sunday morning. So, and taking a nap, that's risky. One little screw up and you've missed the whistle, and that's not good. So yeah, I just stay up. And, so I certainly didn't want to. I mean, looking back on it now, there was something kind of cool about, leaving the Clear Channel building and then taking a drive home, and then I got up at 4, as I say, but they would replay the station here that carried locally, which was 570 Cliff. They would replay the first hour. For a while, I even replayed the first 2 hours. And so I could listen to the show and just kind of like air check myself, just kind of see how it went. But then after that, I kind of went into that John Lennon thing where it was, when he was asked one time, do you ever listen to any of those songs that that you and the Beatles recorded? And he said, no. You know, so as soon as he's heard the final mix and it's gone to record, he just moves on to the next thing. And that's the way it got. I thought, well, I can either do it or I can't, and the audience will let me know. And if they don't, then the management will let me know. So I'm just going to do it, and I'm not going to continue to air check myself like this. I was there when the interview was conducted. So, or really, I don't even consider it to be an interview. I like to think of it more as just a conversation. I was there for the conversation. There's no point in listening to a recording of it. So after, I don't know, 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 occasions, I just quit listening to the replay.
Another audience question here. We're flooded with audience questions. Was John B. Wells blackballed because he went on the Alex Jones show?
You know, I don't think so, because Mr. Norrie and Alex, they seem to have a rapport. You know, George Norrie shows up on Alex Jones' show all the time, and I think Alex comes on to... No, as a matter of fact, I just remembered something, and that was that I wanted to get Alex Jones on the program early, and this was back in like 10 or 11, but I was told that, no, Alex is really more George's guest. It's like, okay, I get it, fine. But eventually, before I got Alex Jones to come on the program with me, Alex Jones reached out to me and had me come on his program. So, look, I understand how these guys are... They're capitalists. They're not, you know, there may be an element of carrying the revolution forward and all that, but I don't expect Alex Jones to, you know, throw Norrie overboard so that he can continue to have a relationship with me. That's not how it's done. While Alex and I are certainly, I don't think that we're in an adversarial position with each other, it doesn't surprise me that, I think the whole John Wells thing really put a weed up the kilt of the whole Coast to Coast deal. And so I think it's probably in his best interest to just stick with the guy who's still running Coast to Coast. You know, the main host of Coast to Coast. You know, he's got his TV show, and he's got this, and he's got that, and he goes to all these various events and so forth. So really, it just makes sense that he's not going to roll with me on this and throw Coast to Coast under the bus. That's not going to happen. You know, he gets a lot bigger play with Coast than he would with me, at least for now.
How much of these shows are entertainment and how much are education? And which is the more educational of the two, that being the Alex Jones show and Coast to Coast AM?
I would submit to you that Coast to Coast AM has been described to me by some of the people who would be in a position to say such a thing, as a variety show. So I would say that most of it, I think most of it was for entertainment purposes only, or really, I would call it amusement. Entertainment, to entertain something means to hold within. So if this means being transfixed to the station as far as your attention is concerned, then this can be done one of two ways, either with some kind of content that's compelling one way or another. Some of it is for amusement, and some of it is for information. Now, I have noticed that it appears that that Coast has sort of upped their game a little bit as far as bringing more, I would say, more salient information to the public. But they're not going to go too far with that. I mean, we go all the way, and we go over the edge. And I believe guests who come on Caravan to Midnight, I'll always leave them an out. If I want to ask a question, I'll just tell them, if you don't want to answer this question, it's completely okay, and it's not an indictment if you choose not to. Okay? You are free to say whatever you wish, just, you know, I mean, within the bounds of civility. We don't want to run anybody off with any rough language, because it tends to prejudice your entire, you know, your entire thesis. So, other than that, just let it rip. And I can't imagine that that's the case on something that's broadcast over the public airwaves. Although it was that way when I was in the chair, and that they might have had a problem with that. And you know what? If they have a problem with that, that's their problem, because you can only suppress the truth for so long. And the truth is a wonderful thing, because it does not require anyone's belief in it to exist. And so if someone decides that they want to discuss what's really happening, but, oh, there's got to be some official barrier to doing this. I'll tell you, for example, today we spoke with Patrick Wood about the Trilateral Commission. And I want to tell everybody that the Caravanners always get the program first. They deserve that because they are the lifeblood of Caravan to Midnight, literally. But after that, we don't put a lot of stuff up on YouTube anymore. We did for a while. But this is definitely, if ever there was a program worth paying for, the paltry sum that's asked for it, this would be it. However, that said, I want to put this program up on YouTube and let anybody who wants to see it as many times as they want to. Because this is all about the Trilateral Commission and exactly how many Trilateral Commission members are in positions of power and exactly what the agenda is. I asked my father, and as a matter of fact, what I'm about to tell you was on the program today, and I've said it many times. My grandfather helped build the USS Maryland, the battleship on which my dad was attacked at Pearl Harbor. And I am named after my grandfather. That's why I am the second, okay? We don't really do juniors in our family. I don't know why, but we don't like maybe we don't like the suffix. I don't know. But I asked my dad one time, your father predicted the war with Japan years before it happened. What do you predict? What's the next one? And my dad was just musing with his pipe in his mouth. He got this little wan smile. He said, the thing about the next one is you won't know who you're fighting. And that stayed with me for about 40 years now. And it's true. But I guarantee you'll find out who you're fighting after today's program. This man put forth a presentation and a collection of facts and references that were stunning. And we are in the United States, but not just the United States. The entire world is being embroiled in this. And basically, it's not communism, and it's not socialism. It's much worse than that. It's technocracy. And Patrick Wood will explain exactly what technocracy is. And this isn't some woo-woo tinfoil hat stuff, although, you know, tinfoil hats have their uses. If I'm going to get one of those, I'll get a tinfoil sombrero. But I can really shield some stuff out. But this is not nebula. This is not theory. This is fact. And I have never heard anybody put it together like Patrick Wood did. Unbelievable. So, look forward to it. It'll be up Friday night. And I invite everybody to take a look at it, because you will never be the same after you see this. It will sober you, and it will inflame your revolutionary spirit. And in fact, I think it will dial the flame up just a little bit on your human spirit when you see what these quite literally mad scientists have planned for all of us. You know, I don't know if you're old enough to remember this, but there was a show in the 60s. I was a kid. It was called The Man from U.N.C.L.E. You remember hearing about it?
Yeah.
With Napoleon Solo and Julia Kiriak, and it was Robert Vaughn and David McCallum. It was just a great show. Well, U.N.C.L.E. stood for United Network Command for Law and Enforcement. And I don't know how it is that I managed to remember these things for, I don't know, 50 years. But I remember seeing a Man from U.N.C.L.E. book, a paperback book, and I thought, oh, I got to have this. Well, the enemy of James Bond is Spectre. Well, the enemy of the Men from U.N.C.L.E. was known as Thrush. And in this book, Thrush was an acronym for Technological Hierarchy for the Removal of Undesirables and the Subjugation of Humanity. We are most assuredly dealing with Thrush. We really are. And it pervades every aspect of our lives. And when we have a choice, roll with it or rail against it. And we can do that. And then Mr. Wood will tell us how to do it as well. So that's the juice for me. You know, we're all going to check out of here one way or another. It doesn't matter if it's a It doesn't matter if it's a disease, a banana peel on the sidewalk, a car crash, whatever. Nobody gets to live forever, although some of these furry truly think that we can by 2045. Still, they're not going to make it, but they are mad scientists. This has been going on since the early 30s, and it has never fully gone away. In fact, if it's done anything, it's gotten sneakier, and it's more covert, but it is more relentless than even it was back then. It's absolutely amazing.
I have another audience question here. I am a subscriber to Caravan to Midnight, and I love it. My question would be, what does John think about Obama's new net neutrality law, and whether at all he is concerned about how it relates to his subscription-only service? Good question.
Yeah, it is.
Before you get into it, define what net neutrality is.
Well, I wish I could. Now, there are several components that go into all of these things, and we all would like to have a somewhat, I'm not going to say a simple answer, but I'm going to say an easily intelligible one, and we see a problem, or we see a solution, or maybe we see both, but unfortunately, these programs, the only thing that we, the people, are permitted to see is the stuff that sounds good. We're number 31 the last time I checked in internet connectivity, generally. We're behind Estonia. We're number 31. So, if net neutrality really is just making sure that preferential treatment is not granted to this company or that company as far as delivering their content, well, that's fine. But when it turns into this public utility thing, then this opens the door for all kinds of regulations and all kinds of taxes and all kinds of censorship. And so, I do not believe that the government ever imposes anything that is solely for the benefit of the people. It always has a money component, and it most assuredly always has a control component. So I can't really answer that question because I simply have not read the 322 pages. I haven't read it. And even if I had read it, it will require some study because I'm sure there are some components in there that you're going to have to stop and go, okay, now what is this and what does it relate to and how far does it go back and who started it and what's it connected to and who's behind this? There's always a monetary and a control component, always. And control is much more important than money because once you have the control, the money will follow. So that's my answer to that question. I think it is a potential threat, but I am not certain of it. But I'm going to conduct our operation as if it were a threat. And that way, you know, it's better to be prepared and have the preparation not needed than to be unprepared and find yourself woefully remiss in your preparedness. I'll put it that way.
You've interviewed a lot of people over the years. Of all the interviews, which stands out as the worst and which is the best, the most memorable interview for you?
Well, Ray Bradbury is the most memorable, simply because he's Ray Bradbury. And he was all about love and going to the moon and faith in the human race. Now we were going to expand. We're going to do all these wonderful things. It was just great. It was real food for the soul. But I believe one night I interviewed, well, I had Stephen Quayle on there and several other people who were people of faith and still are. And so a counterpoint was suggested. It's like, would you like to interview a Satanist? And I went, not really, but I'll interview the Easter Bunny if you can get him on the program, or her. I never found out the Easter Bunny was male or female, but whatever. So on came this Satanist, and I thought, you know, if I'm going to sit through any of this rubbish, I'm going to make him sit here for the whole show, and I did. So 4 hours later, what we got was that, yeah, for $750, he'll put a hoodoo on somebody or take one off of you, and he described himself as being a person who had grown up in privilege. And I said, well, why would you want to be a Satanist? He said, well, because he wanted to live a life of privilege and so forth. But see, those were the, as time went by, I found that the gentlemanly approach to things was not going to work in all instances. And when I say gentlemanly, that's probably not the best word. To deal with these guests with some deference to the fact that they were guests rather than potential adversaries. Now, there's one person, even the sickness, he was just funny, you know. And I think he was mad because I kept him in the chair for 4 hours, making him reveal himself, which by the time it was all over with, it was like there wasn't anything there. Nothing. But I'll tell you what. I'll never have him on the program because I'm quite certain he won't come on. All it'll be is a brawl. And that would be Dr. Lawrence Krauss, friend of Jeffrey Epstein.
He's been on my program.
Who wrote a book called, I don't like this guy.
He's a prick. I'm going to just tell you that right now.
He's a complete prick. He's a pompous prick. Yeah, and you know, Jeffrey Epstein, the pedophile, procurer, pimp, scumbag, is one of his friends, which doesn't surprise me in the least. He wrote this book called A Universe from Nothing, which is about as juvenile a thing as I've ever heard. Because all it is the universe is so cool, it's like, it's so cool that it, insert bong bubbling noise here, it caused itself to exist, it's so cool. This is like saying we found a pyramid that is so cool, we're convinced that it created itself. And then he goes on and on about what a scientist he is, and yet he's a theoretical physicist. Well, science is not theory. Science is being able to create a condition and then repeat it under controlled, or otherwise known as empirical, conditions or environment. This guy, in my opinion, is no scientist at all. He is another person who's been fattened by grant money, and if he really does believe this stuff that he's putting out, well, he's even more pathetic than I thought. Now, normally I don't get on there and in fact, I never do, but this guy, I'd love it if he came on the program, because to me, if you're listening, Dr. Krauss, you are a poor scientist, and you keep really, really bad company, and because you do it willfully, that tells me all I need to know about you. So yeah, Lawrence Krauss is the worst interview ever. By the time it's all over with, he's got people that I feel pretty sure, I can't prove it, but it's my opinion that some of these little nasty people would call up, and of course the screener would let them through. They're saying everything from Jesus was gay to Jesus was a woman to, you know, all this stuff. And I'm listening to all of this. And I'm thinking, man, I would like to pull this guy's brain out, you know, and put it in a formaldehyde-filled jar. But, and that's really the mild version. I was thinking of other body parts, actually. But I just let it go. And I got to tell you, I've never really lived that down to myself. Even though, looking back at it, it was probably handled exactly the way that it should be. And I'm sure that it gave the people who would like to support this person's work, I'm sure it gave them a little giggle to see me take a little bit of a trimming from this guy. But again, as time has gone by, he winds up in print talking, well, as a scientist, you know, and it's in an article containing the filthy name Jeffrey Epstein.
Yeah, I just cut him off early. We only went 22 minutes.
Oh, excellent. Good for you. I wish I'd done the same thing. I wish I could jump in the time machine and go back and go, you know what? We're done. See you. Click. We're going to open lines. That's what I would do now.
Yeah, he was actually a bit surprised, but I mean, he's just so unfriendly. It's not worth my time.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, I had to grow in it. I had to grow into the gig, and that's all there is to it. You know, woulda, coulda, shoulda, but I didn't. So that's it. We all do things. We can't live down to ourselves, and that's one of them in my little book. So, but yeah, that was a bad one.
Another audience question. This one's a little ridiculous, but, you know, if you spend the time to write the question, I'll ask it on the show.
Sure. It makes perfect sense.
Yeah, as long as I don't get 300 questions. So, did Art Bell kill Ramona? And what pedophile network is Art Bell in?
Well, you know, I spoke with Arthur Bell one time, and it was on the 7th, 10th, 9th, 8th, on the 7th of February, which I thought was really cool to speak with him during our birthday week of Caravan to Midnight. But I don't know Arthur Bell. I have no idea that he caused his wife any harm. I can't imagine he did, because by all accounts, he adored her. And, you know, he was accused of being a pedophile back in the day. And now, this is just my understanding. I do not have first-hand knowledge of this. This is nothing but wild speculation actual intel. But someone accused Art of doing this, it's my opinion that it's rubbish, actually. But who knows? But he was pretty upset, as I understand it, that Clear Channel did not come to his defense and would not help him out with this. Eventually, the allegations, and there were never any charges, of course, but the allegations went away, and that was it. So, you know, before I would, people who are in public life like that, their name is out there, that's actually their real name. You know, anybody can start a rumor about anybody. And I don't know, I think I would be very careful about stuff like pedophilia, because we had a guy come on the program who we said, listen, we want to cut you back to just an hour, and like, no, he really wanted to, he really wanted to be on the program. Really wanted to. He really had some unbelievable information. He'd been on the program before. But what he did 2 days before Christmas was tantamount to backing a dump truck full of vile refuse and manure and just dump it in the front yard right by the nativity scene. And it was about pedophilia. So after I heard this, oh, he wanted us to put it up on YouTube, and he wanted us to do all this stuff, and he was talking about how he expected to be arrested and how you know, he imagined the prison life was going to be terrible. And I said, really? Okay, so at the end of the deal, I got a hold of one of our guys. I said, find out where this guy is and tell the local authorities what he's done, because if he comes on this program, and we never aired it, he comes on this program and dumps some stuff out like this. This is not government conspiracy. This is not a whistleblower. This isn't any of that. This is a freak. And whether he's completely full of it or whether he's on the level, I'm not going to have any part of it. So you find out where he is, and then you alert the local constabulary that this is what this guy just tried to foist on us. And that was that. So in this game, you're allowed to run into, I never really thought of it as a game, but apparently it is a game for some people, and I guess this guy thought that he was going to get us to play, and we didn't. So as far as Mr. Bell is concerned, there's no evidence to support him having caused any harm to his wife, and there's certainly no evidence to support that he's a pedophile in any way, so I would say just retire that and forget about it, and do not gin up controversy like that, because it's wrong. You don't have the facts. Why would you want to ask somebody a question like that in a public forum? Now bleep off, you know? I mean, that's the long and the short of it.
Another question here. I'd be interested in knowing what John thinks of Midnight in the Desert as the name of Art Bell's forthcoming show.
Okay. I'm not a Crystal Gayle fan, I can tell you that. Bless her. But, yeah, why not? Midnight in the Desert. Sounds kind of cool.
I like Crystal Gayle. I think she was, at least, pretty hot.
Well, she was really hot to look at. I didn't care for the music much, but I think I'd go with, who is that, Muldaur? Midnight at the Oasis. I think I'd go with that. What's her name? Maria Muldaur. Muldaur? Yeah, Maria Muldaur. That's actually kind of a cool name. Midnight in the Desert.
So it doesn't concern you? You don't think it's a play on Caravan to Midnight?
Oh, who knows? Maybe it is. But if it is, then thanks for the compliment.
Another question here. This one from Thailand. Sorry, John, gots to know, dude. What are your thoughts on Palestine? Also, how would he order a coffee? Cheers, big ears.
Well, usually I get big nose. I asked some people close to me, I said, do I have a big nose? And they were like, what? And I went, yeah, do I have a big nose? They were like, oh, no. I said, are you sure? It's like, well, I mean, it's substantial, but it's not big. Well, I don't know. Some smart ass in traffic said, called me big nose. And I just called him a dumbass, and we were even.
Oh, now you've got something else to be insecure about.
Yeah, absolutely. I think I'll just put on my shemag and just walk around like that. By the way, that is the best idiot repellent anybody could ever put on their head. You wear a shemag, you know, you don't have to wrap it across your face, just roll it up there Bedouin style. And I'm telling you, people bow and scrape at the supermarket. The cops look at everything but you. People are like, I'm so sorry, sir. You go ahead in traffic because they think you're going to pull your ripcord. You just put on a shemag and just, you can see how to fold it and all of that on YouTube. There's a bunch of videos up there on it, and that's where I went to figure out how to do it. It's the best tool that you can have. It's a great scarf, everything else. Anyway, where can you get a coffee? What do I think about Palestine? And what do I think about, what was the other part of his question?
How would you order a coffee? How do you take your coffee?
Oh, when I order a coffee, it's like, depending on the size of the cup, it'll either be two or three sugars. I don't like white sugar. I like the natural sugar, in as much as that's possible to have. And a good dose of half and half. With tea, it's going to be milk. What do I think of Palestine? That whole situation over there is so complicated. Let me just put it this way. That region of the world has been in conflict for thousands of years. Now, people can go and they can say, well, what about the Crusades? Like, go read up on the Crusades and then come back and ask about, well, what about the Crusades? I don't think there's going to be it. Look, the whole thing, what do I think of Palestine? I think that there are people suffering in Palestine. I think there or whatever. I mean, Palestine, that's kind of a made-up deal. I think the Romans came up with that. That part of the world has been subjected. That's the Holy Land. That's all there is to it. As far as turning over control of the holy sites to the Palestinians, I would say no. I think the Israelis are good guardians of those sites. I think there are poor people suffering in Palestine. I think there are poor people who are suffering who are Israeli. I know that when they decided they were going to, okay, let's return some of the settlements to the Palestinians, the Jews got run out of the Israelis, they got run out of there. They just got their homes bulldozed and they got run out of there. So it's like there's enough suffering, insanity, and murder to go around. I am not a geopolitician. I cannot say, well, Palestinians should definitely have their own state. I don't know the answer to that question. Well, you know, the such and such and thus and so, they just created Israel out of nowhere. No, not really. Yes, that did happen, but the state of Israel, I mean, with quotes around the whole thing, existed all the way back to before the New Testament was written. So, one sure way to cause an inflammatory argument is to get into the Palestinian-Israeli thing. And as I like to say, I am alternately a Zionist, a Nazi, a left-wing wacko, a right-wing wacko, an idiot, or a genius, depending on what part of what sentence someone thinks they heard me say. So really, where that's concerned, I can tell you this, I'm glad that Netanyahu remained in power. I am, because I do not believe for a moment that Iran does not have a nuclear weapon. And we've gone through, yes, we installed the Shah. Yes, the Shah was a bastard who lived in opulence while the people suffered. Yes, we know this. Yes, we know that Ayatollah Khomeini, who was exiled, came back. And hostage this, and execution that, and crazy this, and then we had Ahmadinejad, and then whoever's in there now. And so, all it takes is the wrong guy to get in there, and just decided, we must kill all the Jews! And some of these people really think they're gonna usher in the last imam and all of that. I don't know. I just think that part of the world, if you go over and talk to the Persian people, and that's what they are, the Persians in Iran, they're perfectly wonderful people. But it's not the people that cause the problems. The people are the ones who react to the problems. 90% of all the casualties in any war are civilians, and it's because the civilians allow it. It was the tiny minority of leaders that caused this huge amount of bloodshed, no matter what conflict you're talking about. I wish that there were some way to stay out of the Middle East and just divorce ourselves from any initiative in any of those conflicts, but we can't. How that little country of Israel has so much clout, I really don't know. I mean, some of it must be scripturally based. I mean, when it says, you know, the Jews are God's chosen people, it's like, well, chosen for what? That's the first question. I mean, chosen to, like, run the mass media and the banks and everything else? Like, I don't know. There are good people among the Jews, and there are some pretty rough customers among the Jews. Just like in every other race, group, nation, or social club. So to just, for me to just pop off and say, well, what do I think of Palestine? It's like, well, there's a lot of rocket fire over there. A lot of rockets coming into Tel Aviv, a lot of rockets, a lot of killings. But this is just, this is the same way of saying, you know, because of these idiot Black Panthers and some of these morons down in, wherever it is, Ferguson, Missouri and all of this, their actions do not speak for all of the black people out there any more than the Ku Klux Klan speaks for all white people. And when we generalize like that, we're just painting ourselves into a corner. And if we keep painting and the corner gets, you know, the space between the paint and the corner gets smaller and smaller, the only way that you can get out of that corner is to burst out of it with great ferocity and energy, and which is otherwise known as war. So, is there a two-state solution? I don't know. Maybe. Is anybody going to be satisfied with the two-state solution? I don't think so. Somebody is going to get the idea, we've already gotten our two-state solution. Now we are in a position to kill the Israelis. I mean, there's got to be somebody over there thinking that. I don't believe that the Israelis are going, we must kill all the Palestinians. If they are thinking that, I haven't heard about it. It's a mess. And frankly, I'm not qualified to make those calls, really, even in theory. I don't know what's to become of that region of the world. I really don't. But when you see these, and who knows, we see all this stuff about, like, ISIS, for example, another CIA construct, by the way, it appears, supposedly destroying all of these religious artifacts. Well, some say they're not really doing that at all, though that's staged, designed to inflame the hearts of people against ISIS. Well, to what end? Well, to keep the conflict ginned up. There's big money in, there's a lot of money in dope, but I'll tell you, there's a lot more money in arms. A lot more. That's what Benghazi is all about, as will be revealed at some point in the future. So that's just a terrible question to attempt to answer. All people living in peace, that's a little bit of a stretch. We may have to settle for all people living and just let it go at that.
You just mentioned their name. Another question from the audience here is, what does John think of the new Black Panther Party who were protesting with guns chanting oink oink bang bang at SXXW in Austin?
Oof. There's a lot of anger out there. And I think they're angry, misguided people. And at best, I think they're violent, murderers in waiting. It doesn't seem to me that, they're doing the same thing as saying, as painting all cops with the same brush that you would trash that killed that kid, Kelly Thomas, out there in California. Those guys weren't police. Those guys were pigs. But there are policemen. There are people who care. Now, when you see that George Soros is really behind all of this, he wanted to generate civil action. Well, and then some murderous idiot goes up there and just smokes these two cops up in New York City. Those guys weren't doing anything but sitting in their police car. Well, they might have been dirty. Well, they might not have been dirty, too. Well, they might have been bad cops. Well, they might not have been bad cops. They might have been good cops. Family men, people who liked them. Guys who actually wanted to be cops because they thought they could, quote, make a difference. You don't know what their character is. But what we do know is that after that happened, the arrest and summons, otherwise known as a ticket, that stuff dropped like some unbelievable, more than half. I may not be correct, but I want to say it was like 66% or something, which tells me that there were a lot of cops out there being told by their superiors, who were being told by their superiors, who were being told by their superiors, to get out there and write tickets and make some arrests and get this going on, because crime and misdemeanors are big business. But it also says to me that the police department was out there messing with the undeserving. And so when it was made to look like, you know, you mess with the wrong people and you may not make it home, your badge and gun notwithstanding, well, cops are human beings too, and when they decided, you know, if they're going to start shooting us like this, maybe we don't necessarily need to lay our lives on the line to pull somebody over or write somebody a ticket. Okay, that's fine. At the same time, when de Blasio put an end to stop and frisk, crime shot up. So here's the thing. We have a real problem here with race. We really do. Now, on the one hand, there's part of me that says, you know, if you guys really want a race war, you can have it. Let's just settle this right now. Now, that's the somewhat irrational side of me. On the other side is, well, they're never going to accept that the Civil War was not fought over slavery. They're never going to get that. There's millions of them. They're never going to get past the slavery issue at all. They're not going to listen to any parallel that you may try to draw between the treatment of the Irish, the treatment of the Italians, the treatment of the Jews. They're not going to listen to that. They don't care. They're not going to, they're not going to entertain for a moment the idea that the Civil War was not fought over slavery, because it wasn't. Abraham Lincoln said, if I could save the Union by freeing the slaves, I would. If I could save the Union and free no slaves, I would. There was no repatriation back to Africa or any of that. You know, it's just, these human beings are a mess. And it gets worse when they form into groups. But I would also submit that the cops are brutal. They absolutely are. But they choke out white people and shoot white people all the time. This guy that got shot in Dallas a couple of days ago, oh, there are black cops, they're shooting him too. So I don't know why brutality has ramped up so much all over the place. But now my advice to anyone is that unless you're prepared to get shot yourself, don't call the police at all. Because if they show up and they're not sure what's going on, then they may just start shooting, and you may wind up being the victim, a bigger victim than you were before you called them because of the home invasion or something. I mean, there are all kinds of videos up there about how police treat people, and it's wrong, and those people should be fired and in some cases jailed and put into the general population and have the general population told that they're cops. That's what should happen, because I assure you, you know, if you do that a couple of times, they're going to behave themselves on the street. But again, you take some military guy who's half nuts, maybe he's got PTSD that's under control, at least visibly under control, but maybe not completely. Maybe he's on Prozac. Maybe he drinks. Maybe he beats his wife. I mean, you never know. These are just people. These are armed men. When you have a situation where you have to call an armed man or woman to the scene who have the power of life and death over you, you better be calling them for a good reason. You know, it's just, and it won't get any better. Imagine how they'll behave when if the citizens were to lose their right to keep and bear arms. How much worse would it be then? I think we know how much worse it would be. Human nature is what it is. And people like power. You can see it on you can see it in the whatever department at the Walmart. You can see it in the halls of government. You can see it in the police departments. You can see it in the schools. Anywhere there are groups of people and there's any kind of a hierarchy established, you're going to find a measurable percentage of people who just want power. And in fact, some people are looking for a legal excuse to kill, a legal license to kill people. They do it all the time. But this is not confined to black people solely. And to hear these, and see the mainstream media, that's another thing. All you have to do is say something, and because it gets broadcast one time over some outlet, like whether it's a Fox News or an MSNBC, the perception is that it's widespread. And it's not widespread. It's just one report. That's it. But it's in the people's, it's in a lot of people's heads. And that's that seed that starts to grow. So if they see another symptom of somewhere, then they're absolutely convinced that the report was about something that's widespread. And that may not be reality at all. It's just perception. Well, perception is reality. Yeah. That's the flip side of that coin. It's like that old Louisiana lawyer said one time, no matter how thin you slice it, every piece of bread got two sides. And it's true. I think the Black Panthers or criminal organizations should be disbanded. I mean, they were intimidating voters. I mean, it was the Ku Klux Klan standing around saying, what are you doing here, Blackie? Well, no. There were Black Panthers standing around going, what are you doing here, Whitey? What are you doing here, Cracker? Look, it's the same sauce for the goose and the gander. Quit messing with people. But as far as you know, maybe there is a huge Kill Whitey movement out there. I mean, I don't see it, but if I do, I know what countermeasure I'll take, and I'm sure everybody else will, too. It's, you're going to have to revert to the law of the jungle. If you're strong enough and fast enough, you survive. If you're not, you won't. Hopefully, it won't come to that. Sometimes I think that a race war is actually wanted. I think there are people in government that would really like to see this country reduced to third world status. They're already trying to destroy our sovereignty with this ridiculous influx of illegal immigrants. And yet Mexico is having a bullet train built by the Chinese. Where's our bullet train? Where's our high-speed train? America, the great shining light to the world. Really? We have a nuclear power plants that are cracking at the seams. No high-speed, super high-speed rail. It's only 5% unemployment. Yeah, 5% unemployment. Where do you come up with that number when you got 92 million people who are not in the workforce at all? It's one lie after another. And the only reason that any of us even know about the Black Panthers is why? Because the news media reports their activities to us. And it looks like this huge movement. The big tsunami-sized wave of Black Panthers is going to come get the white folks. I don't buy it, not for a minute. Black and white people get along pretty well. It's people outside of the so-called community that agitate and cause friction between us. Where are the jobs programs? The great Barack Obama. What a fraud. This guy hadn't done anything for black people. I talked with Pastor David Manning a couple of times, and the guy up in Harlem, and pastor up there. And he's the one that said we gave him everything, and he failed. And he used the N-word. And the thing is that we are able to get along. We want to get along, but there are people who do not want us to get along. Some of them are within the. Some of them make money, like the Wrangles and the Sharptons and the idiot Jesse Jackson, people like that. And Barack Obama, you know, Ferguson is worthy of protest. Let's add that to. I'm pretty good at killing people. How about stay the course? I mean, what kind of a so-called leader would say those things? Why is he going, listen, we can resolve our problems. There's going to be an investigation. If anybody's guilty, they're going to be prosecuted for that. But I urge calm. I want you to calm down. Don't destroy your own neighborhoods. Don't harm any people. No, this bastard doesn't say that at all. Stay the course. Now, they can say Obama's a puppet all they want to, and he may be. In fact, I suggest that he is. He never published anything as a president of the Harvard Law Review. How did he get to that position? Because he's so cool? Maybe he's passing out joints to people as favors or something. Maybe that's what got him in there. His grades weren't good. He and Michelle gave up their law licenses. I wonder why that is. Why not come up with a birth certificate? Why not go, here's my birth certificate. So all these people that are saying that I'm some sort of unqualified illegal alien, it's just, they're just full of it. I mean, here's their certificate. I'll be happy to show it to you. It shows everything right there. Why the big deal over the birth certificate? It's just, it's ludicrous. We are living in an absolute, it's not even an illusional world, it's a delusional world. And we go from one angst inducing event after another. If it's not a first, just like the mainstream media, the way they covered Ferguson, the way they had those camera angles set, they sucked up the depth of field where it looked like this little, like the whole town's on fire. But if you get a little bit of a perspective, you see it's one small building over there that's got a little bit of a fire going. But when they jack that lens in on their reporter and it's standing there, you know, bringing you all the news that you need to know, like a buffoon, which most of them are, in my opinion. Look, I'm not friends with any of these people. I don't want to be friends with these people. I'd rather have no friends than those people as friends, okay? They're in it for a paycheck. They're in it for sensationalism. They do what they're told. They say what they're told to say. Like I said, they got security services all over them telling them what they can say and what they can't. You know, I think it's interesting. I'm all over the place here, but we've had enough of that. There's no point in beating those horses. They're already dead. There's no point in making any glue here on your show. Let's take Sony Pictures. CIA, according to reports, which popped up on the scope and then magically went away, visited Sony Pictures 2 or 3 weeks before that alleged hack that Kim Jong-un in North Korea hacked Sony Pictures. And Kim Jong-un's got this look on his face like, what? I didn't hack Sony Pictures. Well, isn't it interesting that Sony Pictures is now going to put out the big, I can't remember what the name of it is at this moment, even though I read the story today. It's a climate skeptic movie. And here come all these assaults about how the guy who's in it, and it's his picture, how he's so skillful and clever and all of this stuff, and just in the end, it's like he's just a big fat liar. It's like this climate, this global warming thing is a total, it's a joke, it's a farce. And when you hear Patrick Wood from today's program on Caravan of the Midnight talk about this stuff, you're going to understand. I mean, it's enough to absolutely make your blood boil, because all these people do is lie. Hillary Clinton. What is it that qualifies that person to hold any office at all? She ought to be holding a big black ball with a chain on it, the end of which is attached to her ankle, and she wears a not very fashionable striped suit.
Harry Truman was a hat salesman. I mean, this is not new. Politicians are never qualified.
Jimmy Carter was a peanut farmer.
Reagan was an actor. I mean, on and on.
Yeah. And, you know, by all accounts, Reagan was not supposed to be president. And, you've got to hear Patrick Wood. You just got to hear it. Love how George H.W. Bush flipped out down there in Florida, because if you don't carry Florida, you're not getting the nomination. And now he wound up as vice president. And isn't it interesting that somehow a guy named John Hinckley takes a shot at Ronald Reagan and hits him, but the family, the Hinckley family, is friends with the Bushes. Really.
Yeah, and Hinckley's now in a mental institution.
Mm-hmm.
Can't say too much when you're locked up in a mental institution.
No, you can't. We are living under such secrecy. However, they're having to accelerate their game a little bit, because too many people are getting wise to it, and eventually the citizens are going to look what happened at Bundy Ranch. I go back to this one a lot. That was an illegal land grab that Harriet Reid was going to try and pull. Pelosi's husband was involved in that land deal. They wanted to set up a solar farm with the Chinese. That was the first. That was a visible entree into taking control of our utilities. Well, those cowboys out there were like, "You come against us with arms." We have arms, too. And these guys were ready. These cowboys were not bluffing. The government turned tail and ran. That's what they did. And that's exactly what they'll do when the people of this country finally have enough of being made to look like a bunch of death-worshipping profiteers, which I'm afraid we look like to most of the world, with no culture whatsoever except a fixation on Kardashian's rump, who Reed, after graduating college at a seventh grade level, were behind on everything, scholastically, everything. when people get enough of this, and they start at the local level, and they actually get off their backsides and go to the PTA meetings, go to the school board meetings, go to the city council meetings, educate your sheriffs, educate. I'm telling you, ignorance that way, madness, which we're experiencing now, and eventually death and destruction, that is the way that that leads. This ignorance is not bliss. This ignorance is guaranteed destruction. They will put an apparatus in place. It's already being put in place now that will absolutely lock down everything you do. And nobody's taking this literally, and they should, because that's exactly what they want. These people have plans for us that you would just not believe. You wouldn't imagine in your wildest science fiction dreams that anybody would even try to do something like this. But they are not only trying to do it, they are doing it. All this ridiculous surveillance so that they know everything you're doing. But again, I'm telling you, I think we've had many, many fine guests on the program, many. But I got to tell you, Patrick Wood hit it out of the park. He hit it out of the park, beyond the parking lot and out into the neighborhoods. When you hear what he has to say and he lays it out, and there's plenty of graphic notation to go along with it, plenty of supporting documents. It's really an excellent presentation. You're going to know who's behind this and how far back. It really doesn't go back that far. It all started rolling with the Kennedy assassination. And 10 years later, this thing called the Trilateral Commission was formed. And they are the ones who are responsible for everything that's happening. Well, the Trilateral Commission, just listen and watch caravanatmidnight.com. Watch it on YouTube. It would be better if you subscribed. The subscribers, the members, are the ones who keep us going. We cannot do this without them. We just can't. And they do. And it's $5 a month. That's it.
Yeah, a couple of audience members here are asking where to listen to the show. Some are asking where to see it or listen to it for free. There seems to be confusion there as to where to listen to your show.
Well, here's the problem. There are a lot of people out there. I heard this guy. This guy put on this, bless his heart, it was just ridiculous. He's going to do a coast-to-coast shout-out. So he puts on these gigantic headphones. He makes this really poor video. And he says, are you going to be a corporation coast-to-coast? It should be for free. It should be put out on the Internet for free so that everybody could hear it without commercials and all this is like powerless. Nothing is free.
Yeah,
nothing.
Let me just stop you there. How do you defend against that? If you're pushing truth and you're against elitism, how do you defend the fact that you have to pay to listen to your show?
Because people have to eat, and they have to pay for electricity, they have to pay for bandwidth, they have to pay for equipment, they have to pay for lawyers. You know, they have to pay for everything, because sooner or later, you get in this game, you get very deep into it, you're going to eventually need a lawyer, and you're going to need a damn good one, too. And we have one. We have more than one. And they watch over us. And they're not just, they're not ambulance chasers. These are serious people who love the law. Or we wouldn't be doing any business with them. Nothing is free. And I don't care how destitute somebody is, everybody has $5 over the course of a month. But if people expect to get everything for free, I really don't know what I can do for them or tell them. As far as I can go with that, I put this stuff up on YouTube, and effectively, you know, YouTube will send you a check after, you know, zillions of hits and so forth, and guess who that pays? Guess where that money goes? It goes to the guy who maintains the channel and the guy who takes down pirated shows from people who think that it's okay to pirate stuff and put it on their own channel so that they can get a check, but they don't actually do anything except steal the show and put it on their channel and wait for a little check from Google. Well, you know what I say? I say screw those people. It's like, look, we're putting our backsides out on the line. Look what happened to Hastings. Look what happened to Philip Marshall. Look what happened to Breitbart. Look what happened to Clancy. I mean, if it's not worth $5 a month, fine. We're going to keep doing it anyway until we run out. We don't have any more members. If it ever reaches the point we don't have any members, then we'll know that our work is rubbish. We don't have any business doing it. But as it stands now, there are members, and membership is strong, and membership is getting stronger all the time. And the more members we have, the more we will be able to do. But that's just part of it. You can't walk. You can't go out during the day without spending a quarter, at least, you know? Anyway, sorry, go ahead.
No, it just sounds like there are seemingly a section of the audience out there that would like to listen to your show that aren't able to.
Well, they can go to YouTube and they can hear a whole bunch of stuff. They're not complete episodes, except in some cases, but we like to give them a taste of it. I mean, we don't expect to just separate them from their money and somehow trick them into, you know, oh, wow, man, I spent $15 for 3 months, and this really sucks. I mean, I'm just speaking to you like a regular guy now. I'm not always the lordly Mr. Wells or any of that. I'm just a regular person just like anybody else. But, well, not anybody else, but like many people. But they can see free stuff. We give them a sample on YouTube. That's why we do it. But, again, we got to pay the guy that puts the stuff up there. And make sure that these programs, he goes all over the world, all over the net, all the time, every day, looking for these pirated programs, he pulls them down. And some of these people that put pirated stuff up, they're pirating coast to coast, they're pirating Hagman and Hagman, they're pirating everything they can get their hands on. We'll pull their whole channel down. It's like, because what they're doing is stealing. You know, you don't steal, we don't steal from each other. The government is stealing from us. They will steal our lives from us if it suits them. And so we're not asking for $150 a month. We're asking for $60 over the course of a year, and you can buy $15 for 3 months. And there's already almost 300 programs in the archive now. So when you sign up for this thing, it's like we're sticking it to ourselves, if anything, because we make sure that this is a low enough cost for this program that cost is not an obstacle to people, even for people whose money is tight. And I understand it. I've heard the screech of the eagle, and I've heard the gurgle of the swamp where money is concerned. And but there is no screech of the eagle where money is concerned now. You walk into a grocery store, you'll be doing good if you get out of there with a small bag of groceries for $50. So, I mean, this is an extraordinarily reasonable price for the quality of guests that we bring on, and that's all I can say. We do our very best to present a high-quality program. And I got to tell you, the membership of Caravan Midnight, when we started this thing up, you talk about a wild, dangerous, careening takeoff. We had every issue on earth. Servers going down, bandwidth problems, internet interruptions, you know, the color wheel on all the computers, weird stuff happening over the mobile phones. We've had to go to mobile phones that are not like any mobile phones most people have ever heard of. Because we get intrusions into our communications all the time. Now, there are some people within the security services that I am sure are way on the down low. We get the feeling from time to time that they're watching over us rather than just watching us. And I think that's good. Look, this is not some made-up acid trip woo-woo stuff here. There is a very, very dangerous agenda afoot right now. It's more dangerous. Well, it's as dangerous, and because they're so technologically advanced, it's more dangerous than the Nazis were back in the middle of the last century. This is not some made-up deal. We're not riding on the coattails of some imaginary conspiracy. This is real stuff. I'm not interested in conspiracy theories. I'm interested in conspiracies. I'm interested in busting criminals, and I understand that there's an element of risk in this. But I also know that there's more life behind me than there is in front of me. And from here to the end of the line, I'm going to do what I'm led to do. And what I'm led to do right now is to do everything that I can to help preserve the last bastion of human freedom on this earth. Because if this bunch wins, we are all well and truly screwed. And I mean big time and permanently. So I may sound a little harsh here, and I don't mean to sound harsh, but I am passionate about this. This is what we do, and we do it at some personal risk. So I'm not expecting anybody to feel sorry for us or anything like that. I just want you to join us and help us. You know, one voice out there in the world, you know, railing against injustice. What a pathetic gesture that is. But if there are a bunch of us, then we can feel that we can make that force be felt. And the ones who are trying to force this evil upon us, and that's what it is. Let me define evil for people who don't believe in it. Evil is the deliberate damage of a person perpetrated by another person on a physical, mental, or spiritual level, that's evil. The destruction of a person on one of those levels, or one or more of those levels, this is evil. Oh, yeah, these cats up here, they think that by 2045 they're just going to be able to live forever. Yeah, technology is going to enable them to do this. Really, you want the caliber of leadership that you've had so far? You want that to live forever? You want that to govern you forever? Another 100 years, another 50 years? Look what happened to Mexico after just having a political party called the PRI in power for 75 years. One guy ran against him, this is back in the 90s, and the next day on the front cover of the newspapers, this guy was all shot out to hell and bled out, right there in color photograph, right on the front. Why would mass media put such a picture on their newspaper? It's to send a message that if you buck the system too much, this is what happens to you. Well, I say the same thing that Sinatra said to Chung King in that World War II movie. Go to hell. I would tell you to go to hell, but you're already there, and you just don't know. You know, that's Jack Valentine from, what was it, Lord of War. But seriously, this is not, this isn't Boy Scout stuff. This is serious stuff. And I just ask people, join us. Join the fight. You got nothing to do between now and checkout day except stand for something or stand for nothing. And that's all on you. So, we welcome you as brothers and sisters in arms. And that's my speech, and I'm sticking to it.
Here's another audience question, almost a comment. John B. Wells is just like Alex Jones. He just wants to maintain the fear and keep the masses consuming. I mean, what does he propose we do aside from buying some friggin' iodine? He's referring to Fukushima there. Are you just spreading fear, John?
No, you know, I understand why somebody would do that. That sounds like a really contrived question. That's not really rooted in any kind of a desire to have the question answered, but I'll give them the benefit of the doubt and say, there's plenty of, you know, you don't need me. First of all, I don't want to be compared to Alex Jones, and I'm pretty sure that Alex Jones wouldn't want to be compared to me. He's got his style, and I have mine, and that's just how that is. I don't sell iodine. I sell other things, but I don't sell them. People buy them. If they don't find value in them, they don't buy them. As far as the fear is concerned, if you're not afraid at this point, well, I'd say just go on down the road. Go on down the road, whistle past the graveyard, so to speak. Just don't worry about it. But if you want, rely on mainstream media for your news. You know, call each other names on the forums. You know, get into, instead of getting off your AWS and going down and actually finding out what's going on in the world, just argue among yourselves there on the forums. That'll get you a long way down the road. No, it won't. And there's no need to gin up any fear. You know, I suspect that the person that sent that email is what is commonly referred to as a shill. That's my first reaction to it. Because nobody's ginning up fear. You have only to read. When's the last time that you looked at any of the news services? When's the last time you read a book? Do you have a dictionary in your house? There are plenty of idiots out there. We're not going to get. We're not going to convert them all to intelligent people overnight. And I don't mind answering a tough question, but that's not what I call a tough question. Now Jones and I have completely different styles, and I'm not going to start slamming Jones here, but it didn't escape my notice that there's a little bit. Oh, look, the cops are becoming militarized. Look, the militarized police are leaning on those protesters out there in Ferguson, and all they're trying to do is just express their views. And my sense of it was that now what you're trying to do is taunt them into beating you up so that you can catch it on video. That's what you're trying to do. We don't do that.
You would say that Alex Jones is an instigator?
I'm not going to say he's an instigator, but I'm going to say that he doesn't mind if it starts hitting the fan. And if he can, maybe tilt the fan a little bit to catch a little bit more stuff going into the back of it, you know, Might reach a foot over there and tap it a little bit. I don't know. He's identified himself to me as a capitalist and a patriot, in that order. And I'll leave it at that. I don't sell products. I don't model bikini underwear or tea bags on my webpage in furtherance of making a buck. I offer products that people are free to buy or not buy. If they find value in them, buy them. If you don't, that's fine too. We do not have sponsors. We may at some point, but we do not have them now. You know, we don't do that right now because we're not going to be dictated to. We're not going to be dictated to at all, ever. So that's it. You know, I'm not going to talk about it. I'm not going to try and make something bigger than it is. If anything, I don't give some stories enough play to suit some people. And besides, the other part of it is this. No matter what you do, I don't care what you do, somebody is not going to like it. You are not going to appeal to everybody. That's just the way it is. So if you know this, then the best thing to do is not, well, who can I appeal to them? What can I say that will appeal to the most people? I don't know. So what we do is we just put on a program. And then we'll find out what appeals to people and what does not. And that's okay. If they don't want to hear it, if they don't want to hear brilliant people come on the program and tell them things that they're not going to hear anywhere else. And certainly they're not going to hear it the way that they hear it. Well, if they don't want to do that, it's a free country. At least so far it is, somewhat free. It's less free than it was, but still somewhat. Let's say we live in a somewhat free country. Nobody's holding a gun to anybody's head to subscribe, become a member. Not at all. It's an invitation. It's not a command.
Another question from the audience. Lots of questions. Are you optimistic or pessimistic about America's future? Whether the country is on the right track or not right now, are you confident it can get on the right track or no? That question comes from Belgium.
I am confident that the country can. I am confident that the country may. I am not convinced that it will. It depends on the apathy quotient, and it depends on the motivational component. Typically, the way that you get people to appear in the streets by the countless tens of thousands is to threaten their money. Well, your money is going to be threatened. Oh, the dollar is at an all-time high. The euro is at like a $1.05 or $1.06 today. French francs down around 99 cents. The British pound, the English pound, is at $1.47 the last time I looked. 46 maybe. So, gee, what happens every time the dollar gets this strong? Answer, something bad. So, it could be that Americans are going to have to taste some real pain, the same way that Belgium did, the same way that France did, the same way that Germany and Italy, England, Russia, all those countries. We haven't experienced anything like that since the Civil War. That's a long time ago. People forget. And with revisionist historians out there, nobody even knows whether the struggle was noble. They don't know whether what the struggle was about. They've been sold this thing that, oh, it was all about slavery. No, it wasn't. It was not about slavery. That was only brought into it at the end. That was just an extra component to push the initiative forward a little bit. Nobody cared about slavery. There were slaves all over the world and had been for centuries. Slaves sold primarily by Nigerians. The originators of slavery. If you don't believe me, you can look it up.
I was just going to say, who do you think was selling the slaves?
The Nigerians sold their own poor people into slavery. Then when they became more powerful, they began to invade other countries and sell those people into slavery. Where do you think the N-word came from? Okay? That's it. If you don't believe me, you can look it up. That's why people need to let this go. So there are so many things. There are so many things stuck in our heads that we just need to let it go, but we won't. But I'm telling you, this whole slavery thing is holding holding black people back real bad. You know, their feelings are hurt about it. They don't feel like they're getting they're getting a piece of the pie that's big enough to suit them, and they're not. Where are the jobs programs? Where is the help? I mean, the citizens here, it's like, okay, we'll bus our kids to a bad neighborhood in the bad school, and we'll bus the kids in the bad neighborhood over to the good part of town, you know, the nice part of town. Well, that didn't work. Well, let's try affirmative action. Well, that didn't work. Nothing works. Why is that? Why have those programs failed? You know, I mean, what kind of a thing is to tell somebody, well, I'm sorry, we can't hire you. You're overqualified for the job. And then these so-called academics, they're nothing but a bunch of retards with attitudes that have been rejected by virtually everybody but other academics. Well, reverse racism is not possible. Well, women can't be sexist because they don't hold political and economic power. It's like, that's just a lie. And that's all it is. One of my favorite women ever walked the face of the earth, aside from my mom, of course, is Dame Diana Rigg, who was, you know, Diana Rigg, the Avengers, and many other things. I think she's been in Game of Thrones. She was knighted, effectively. It's not actually a knighthood, but it comes close. And she said she felt that women were in a much stronger position than, I mean, that's paraphrasing, but those were, that's the majority of those words were hers. She believed that the women have always been in a much stronger position to get their way than men. And I would agree with her. Where are all the feminists when it comes to women's issues? Why are people still patronizing things like Planned Parenthood when Margaret Sanger set it up as a eugenics program to get rid of black babies? Oh, they don't want to hear that. No, they don't want to hear that. People don't want to hear the truth a lot of times because a lot of times the truth will just slap you across the face hard. People don't want that. Well, you can either live in the depths of ignorance and pay the price for it or not.
How about this article further linking Western governments to ISIS? This is another audience question, and I'll briefly read some of this article. The ICE PSYOP has been exposed again after Turkish authorities arrested an ICE facilitator they allege is an agent of the Canadian Intelligence Service, CSIS. The man, a Syrian named Mohammed al-Rashid, who purportedly went by the alias Dr. Mehmet Rezit, was filmed helping facilitate the travel of three British teenagers into Syria to join the Islamic State group. The ICE group is now known to be receiving assistance from multiple Western nations, with elements of the U.S., Israel, and Canada known to support the group, and the support of the French and British can also be safely assumed, if not yet completely proven. Your thoughts on that?
Lee Oswald was CIA. What's his name? The one that Obama supposedly whacked out. What the hell's his name right now? Bin Laden, Osama Bin Laden. Family, great friends of the Bushes. They were immediately spirited out of the country right after the S-11. I like S-11 better than 9-11, you know. Let's see, who else? Oh, yeah, Al-Qaeda. Let's see, ISIS. It's all... Look. Are we fomenting fear? Should we put a little iodine with that, or maybe some bikini underwear along with that story? Gee, would that unseat some people from their little comfortable reality seat to find out that your government is the one, this government formed Al-Qaeda, this government formed ISIS? That whole Benghazi deal was about gun running, illegal gun running. Check out caravanatmidnight.com and listen to Robert Tosh Plumley. Now, I wasn't sure if Plumley was for real or not. I checked him out, interviewed him a few times, checked him out some more. You know, you get into this game like this, you're going to bump into some people that work in those special jobs. Plumley's for real, and it is about international gun running. That's what that whole deal, the first thing that I said when I saw that hit on the CIA compound, that was a safe house is all that was. The CIA annex, no, it was down the road. This was a CIA safe house. That's why it was pretty safe, because it was able to sustain a pretty serious attack for, what, 11 hours, or was it longer than that? First thing that I said when I saw this report was, I said, that's a gun deal that went bad, that's what that is. Oh, really? And they're waving their little black and white Al-Qaeda flag, too. Yeah. And I'll tell you something else. I'm going to go back to Jones here for a minute. I couldn't help but notice that the Bundy Ranch is standoff, but there's a Fox News reporter standing there with a little microphone. It's got a little mic flag on it. But there's another flag blowing in the breeze right behind him, right by a tent with a table set up there with some literature on it and some people manning the table. And it was a little InfoWars flag. So that's one of two things. That's either, hey, all the nuts are here, including InfoWars, or it was like some sort of a mainstream media connection. Now, I'm sure if Jones hears this program, he's not going to be happy with this. I mean, I like him all right, but I don't know him very well. But I don't believe everything that I see to be just happenstance. Coincidence, yes. Accident, no. Obi-Wan Kenobi said, in my experience, there's no such thing in coincidence. Well, I be John Kenobi, and I say that everything is coincidence, a coincidence of events. Accidents, no. We think things are accidents, but they're not. So, yeah, as far as ISIS being, look, how did the underwear bomber, who was the guy that walked him through Schiphol Airport in Amsterdam with no passport, his butt is loaded up, is padded with some crude explosive that set his bomb on fire, along with his poor little genitals as well, and he gets escorted through security by a guy in a suit. Except, well, the authorities decided that they didn't really want to share that video from the cameras with anybody after it was initially seen. Let's go back to 9/11. Oh, Building 7 has fallen down. The BBC reporter's right there. And then, oh, we've lost the transmission because, oh, well, now we've got the transmission back and now the building's down. But when the woman originally reported, it was standing in the background. Look, this whole thing is a fraud, people. You know, I hate to tell you that. I don't like it. It hasn't increased my comfort level any. In fact, it's taken it down a bunch of notches. But there's no surprise here. It came out months ago that ISIS was trained by CIA in Jordan. They've had two accidental airdrops of weapons that were supposed to be headed to the Kurds. And oh, wow, what an accident. They wound up in ISIS hands. They keep talking about these rifles and weapons that say property of U.S. government being found either around dead ISIS people or currently in their hands and being operated. So, and now, at first it was, oh, let's get rid of Assad, got to get rid of Assad. Now it's like, well, we can't get rid of Assad, because if we do, it's going to destabilize things even more. I mean, what they're doing is exactly what Plumlee said. They're selling arms to both sides. And Vladimir Putin's standing over here going, this is BS, is what this is. And it's like, don't start trying to push me around. Well, what are we doing now? Now we've got, they were talking about just the other day, this can't be more than a week or 10 days old, they're sending National Guard to the Ukrainian border. We have caused war after war after war. This goes back a long time ago, this is over 20 years ago, that one of the big three networks, I want to say it was NBC, was going to run a program. Did Franklin Roosevelt know about Pearl Harbor beforehand? And it never aired. I was waiting for that show to come on, and it didn't come on. And I thought, what happened? Well, they scrubbed the program. What happened? They promoted it over the network, but it never ran, never aired. It's because Franklin Roosevelt did know about Pearl Harbor. Knew all about it. That's the only way to pull us out of a depression. Is good for business. Look, you can look at something like the Three Stooges, for freak's sakes, where the guys are sitting around going, armaments factories only made 500 million buckaroos profit for the first quarter. And the other guy goes, we're practically starving. He goes, well, let me remind you, gentlemen, that the kingdom of Moronica is at peace. And the other guy goes, but there's no money in peace. We must start a war. Yeah, but I know. We need a dictator. Yeah, but where can we get somebody who's stupid enough to do what we tell him? I've got the very man, and he's in this house right now. His name is Mo Hailstone. So he calls in Larry and Curly and Mo and makes him dictator of Moronica and all this other stuff. I mean, look, it's a goofy little skit, but it's absolutely correct. It was IBM and numerous other companies did business with the Nazis for the entire duration of the war. But people still buying IBM stuff. They made punch cards. I mean, you think the first punch cards, people think the first punch cards came out in the 60s or 70s, or punch cards that kept up with the prisoners in the concentration camps back in the 40s. And they were IBM cards. People don't want to hear that. They think it's preposterous. Well, it is preposterous, but it's also true. It's a big mess, folks, and everybody's waking up now. And it's time. Look, everything runs on a schedule. We've been asleep for a long time, and now it's time to wake up. And we are waking up. Just like lying in bed. You go, oh, boy, this feels so good. Just lying in bed. I really don't want to get up. You look over at the clock and go, oh, 7:30. I really should get up. And, God, this feels so good. So you lie there some more. Now it's 10 minutes after 8, and you got to be at plant or wherever you have to go by 9. Well, it's 10 after 8, and you're going to be late. In fact, you're absolutely late. No matter what you do, you will not get there on time. Well, we're not on time either, because we've already lost life, limb, credibility, money, prosperity, position in the world. We're losing our future. That's the worst part of it, because we're late. That's okay. Let's just get to the job and get it on and work harder to make up for the time that we've lost. That's the only way out of this. Now, if people want to sit around and bite their nails going, oh, you're just a shill. Really, a shill for what? A shill for what? These people don't even know what a shill is. A shill is somebody who works for, you know, XYZ stuff, incorporated, who pretends to be a customer and comes in and says, oh, man, I love this company. I would not do business with anybody else. I went down the street to Billy Joe Mack's place, and they treated me terribly, and the products were inferior, and you guys' stuff is just great. Well, he's not a customer at all. That's a shill. So find another word. I'll tell you, there's a measurable percentage of this country's population that's suffering from a shortage of maturity. You know, if you want to look for deceit, you need to look at your government. Look, Mark Dice. You know Mark Dice. I love this guy because he's so outrageous.
Mark's from Vancouver.
That's what I understand. He's a California boy now, but he goes out there and he's got all these, may I just use this term, all these dumbasses putting their printed name, their signature, and a birthday next to their signature as they sign up to keep Karl Marx. Make sure that Karl Marx is on the ballot in 2016 so that Obama's, you know, communist agenda, you know, can move forward. And one moron after another is signing this thing. He had them signing up for stuff like the Holocaust Beach Party. He had them signing up for this is the one that really got me. The infanticide program, where parents could, under Obama's infanticide program, parents can relieve themselves of the stress of the children up to age 3. If you just sign this in support of Obama's infanticide program, so that you can kill your kid, you can euthanize your kid up to age 3. And these dumbasses are just all signing up for it. That, I'm afraid, is emblematic of the majority of the population. But take heart, because it was no more than a third, and I suspect it was more like 5%, of the colonists here who supported a revolt against England. But it did happen. But when it happened, well, the power brokers decided, okay, it's happened. Maybe they saw it coming. Maybe they planned it. Who knows? Who knows what the truth really is? But as one of the guests on the program said, there are dogs and cats. If you toss a pebble at a cat, it'll look at the pebble. Because the cats generally look at effects. If you toss a pebble at a dog, the dog will look at you. Because they look for causes. Well, I think we see the effects, everybody. I think it's time we started looking for and at the causes and then do something about it. We're only here for a little while. So do you want to engage or do you not? If you don't, then just shut up and get out of the way. We don't need any more clutter or any more distraction. We don't need any more whining. We need action. We need to cowboy and cowgirl up and get this done. And I'll tell you, some of the greatest cowpunchers of them all are the women. the women are fiercer than most of the men. They've had it with the lunch program that this so-called first lady has foisted on children. They're sick of this common core, and these girls have taken action, and I'm not kidding you either. They are warrior priestesses, and my hat is permanently off to them. And hopefully they'll inspire their men. Maybe they will. You know, if the woman wants to see the concert, and the guy didn't really want to go, but she really wants to see it, he'll go. So maybe the women can get the men to engage a little more, because they're engaging. They really are.
John, you've interviewed a lot of people. You were at Coast to Coast, the Saturday show. At what point does the conversation become too crazy?
It doesn't. I haven't had very many conversations get crazy at all. In fact, I can't think of any that got crazy.
Is there a point, though, that you just cut the caller off, or is there a subject, a topic that you think is so ridiculous you're not even going to entertain it?
Not with a guest. It never happened with a guest, but it did happen on a couple of open line deals where somehow or another Dan Heiser let the same guy get on there on three different occasions. And it all started off with, well, the black man's just not cleaning up the white man's mess fast enough. This guy sounded like he was 2, 3, 4 wines in the evening. And so I just said, mate. He kept going, so I finally borrowed a line from the Duke in the layer cake, and I said, oh, you'd give an aspirin a headache, pal. And I said, just dump this guy, will you? But they kept letting him on the program. I suspect it was by design. So I can't prove it, but that's what I think. But no, I mean, I've had a caller. That was the one caller that really kind of got stupid. But I got to tell you, Tom Shadyac, he's a great Hollywood guy. He's a great Hollywood guy. He directed A Liar, Liar, and a couple other ones. And he was on the program one night. He had written a book, and I can't remember the name of it, but I do remember what he did. This caller came on, and he was angry, and he was bitter, and all of that. And I'm telling you what, Tom talked him down off that ledge. It was masterful, and it was because it was so genuine. It was really what you would call really great radio, because this man was upset. He was irate. He was at the end of his string. I don't even remember what he was at his string about. I just remember the effect. You know, I'm doing the cat thing now, but that was a great piece of broadcasting, because Tom just guided him right out of this mental state that he was in and set him down for a soft landing. It was really beautiful, and I admire Tom Shadyac very much for the way he handled that. Many other people would have been, you know, counter antagonistic with him. He didn't do that. He just talked him right down, and everything ended up happy. And it was really a beautiful thing. So, yeah, other than the caller that I got 3 times, I can't think of another occasion when things got so crazy that it was time to hit the hang-up button. I'm glad.
Someone's asking here, does John B. Wells smoke ganja? Do you smoke pot, John?
Well, it's like the old Ringo Starr song. No, 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 I don't smoke it no more. I'm tired of waking up on the floor. You know, back in the day, I had a puff or two, certainly did. But as time went by, I began to realize that this stuff is not what it used to be. And, I mean, we're talking 70s now. But now it's like, I don't think I touch that stuff at all, because it's been gene-spliced and jacked up, and to where people, even people who smoke it habitually, unless this stuff is grown and you can supervise the growing, and you watch the chemicals, and there's no gene splicing going on, in that case, you might actually get some that will have the effect that it had before people started messing with it. But now it's become a drug that if you smoke too much of it, it's liable to send you into cardiac arrest if you're not careful. It just depends on the individual. These effects vary from person to person, but some people are really having problems with it. And I don't know if this is true or not, but I've heard 2 or 3 reports that they go out and sample. You know, these people want to find out what's up and why this pot was as strong as it was. They went out and tested like 10 samples at a And they found that in at least two of the three studies, 9 out of 10 samples were laced with something else. Sometimes it was heroin. Sometimes it was just a wee little trace of PCP. Not much, not enough to put you on a psychedelic trip, but enough that you could feel the effect. Some of it had cocaine in it, and some other stuff. I can't remember what it was. It's a prescription medication, and it was ground up, and then dissolved in water, and then the weed was soaked in it. It's like, well, yeah. And if you look closely, you'll see that in the 80s, cocaine was much more expensive than pot was. Well, now pot is exponentially almost more expensive than cocaine. Well, what does that tell us? It tells me that there is there's something in there that's hooking people on it. I mean, back in the old days, it's like, oh, yeah, you know, people would smoke it, and then they didn't have any for months on end. It didn't bother them. They'd smoke it for months on end, and then the supply would dry up, and they wouldn't smoke it anymore. And they weren't jonesing and flipping out and getting cranky and ugly because they didn't have any pot to smoke. They didn't have any pot to smoke. Now, when people try and come off of that stuff, they suffer all kinds of agitation from it. Oh, well, yes, I'm sure there are medical applications. You know, we've talked with Gary over in Eastern Europe there about hemp oil and so forth, and I'm sure there are medicinal benefits to it, but you don't know what you're getting now. Probably you'll be all right, but maybe not. Now, the government, apparently Marlboro, has decided that they're about to start. They may be doing it already, but I saw the pack and I saw the story about how they it's a green. It looks like a pack of Marlboro Greens, you know, the menthol deals, except it's got a marijuana leaf on it now, and they're going to start selling it in Colorado and Washington and any other states that have approved it. But I don't know how it's going in D.C. I don't really care how it's going. You know, if people feel the need to be drugged every day of their lives, what does that tell you? You know, you want to be drunk on the street? Well, you don't get drunk unless you drink alcohol. It's like, all right, you want to be physically impaired on the street by an external influence? What's wrong with you? You know, you can't take any drug that you use habitually is a problem unless it restores you to a normal condition, meaning you're able to function, think straight, and exploit all of your capabilities and talents effectively and consistently. You are abusing a drug, and you can disguise it or say, well, it's legal, I can do what I want. It's like, well, just because it's legal to carry a firearm doesn't mean that in some states, it doesn't mean that you go shooting it off all the time. So that's my analogy. I don't think drugs are helping anybody. I mean, witness all of these things that are, these other drugs that are not strictly made to get high on. You see, Fox News is one of the worst ones. They have a different drug every break, and then right after that is the lawyer commercial that comes on that if you've taken this drug that they just advertised, you may and suffered death. You know, they're talking to the audience saying if you or someone you know has suffered death or injury as a result of taking this drug, it's like, I think I suffered death. Can I get some money too? You know, there's a stoner response to that. It's like when you look at this proliferation of drugs, look. We're a very small percentage of the population of the planet, and we consume 50% of the pharmaceuticals. Coincidence? Probably not.
What do you think is the most underreported news story right now? What should people be paying attention to but aren't?
The corruption in the government and the unwillingness of the judiciary to do anything about it. Look, this government's been hijacked in the same manner that Chicago was run by gangsters and still was run by gangsters all the way back into the first part of the last century. Oh, yeah, you know, he's our friend, you know. Yeah, he helps us out. Well, he helps you out because he wants favors from you. And he helps you out to the detriment of other people who are not giving him or her what they want. So I would say it's corruption in government combined with the manipulation of the mainstream media. As a matter of fact, I think I would put the manipulation of the mainstream media even above corruption in government, because governments all have a corrupt component. But the fact that they can tell the media what to tell the people, I would say that's an even higher crime. That's not even misdemeanor grade stuff. That's a crime to me, to deliberately twist and spin stories to produce a public response. Those are the big ones to me.
Last audience question of the day. I really enjoyed his show on the Boston bombing. Does John B. Wells think the Boston bombing was a hoax?
Well, I can say this. I wasn't there, so I can't say that I know. But it certainly looks like a hoax to me. I would never entertain putting on that kind of a presentation if I didn't think there were a strong there exists a strong possibility that that whole deal was bogus. I'm inclined to think that it is. There's just too much. Some of that stuff was so moronic. I mean, like this woman who's flipping out, this young woman's flipping out about the fireworks on the 4th of July after the bombing. You know, and then her weenie boyfriend is there going, you know, just make it stop, make the fireworks stop, make it stop, all this stuff. And she's filming herself doing this ridiculous emotional act with her little phone. Give me a break. And somebody rolling down the street in a wheelchair with his leg shattered and shin bones are sticking out, but there's no blood trail. No tourniquets. Everybody's got their pants sliced. I mean, you watch that Boston bombing thing, and if you're going to tell me you think that that's 100% legitimate, then there's nothing I can do for you. So I guess the answer to your question in the end is, yeah, I think it was phony. I think the Sandy Hook deal was totally phony. I think 9/11 was phony. And I think this Benghazi deal was phony.
Well, they can't all be conspiracies, and they can't all be false flags. Or can they?
Of course they can.
It's very hard to keep a secret.
You know, brother, not really. When you have people, you know that expression, there's honor among thieves? Now, some people say there's no honor among thieves. Oh, yes, there is. The expression is there is honor among thieves. It's because they're all guilty. And so if they're not tight with each other, and somebody's going to rat somebody out, and then they're going to get in trouble, they all go down. If one of them falls and rats just one in that circle out, chances are good that the other ones are going to fall too, and then you're going to have the whole circle of thieves. It's very easy to keep these secrets, especially if your very lives depend on it. You know, is it a coincidence that Breitbart was dead but right before he was going to release all this information about Obama? You know, is it a coincidence that Michael Hastings, his Mercedes-Benz just blows up? Of course, Princess Diana's car was doing, I don't know, three times the speed that Hastings' car was, and it crashes in that tunnel. It didn't explode and burn, but Hastings' car did. And oddly enough, the front of the car was not damaged, nor was it even burned. I mean, is it Tom Clancy? There was nothing wrong with him, but the word is that Hastings and Clancy and Breitbart were doing an expose on CIA. Well, they're not going to fall for that. CIA is real powerful. That's about the last organization on earth anybody would seriously want to mess with, you know. They'll just take care of you. What about the D.C. madam who was on Alex Jones' show who said, let's put it this way, I'm not going to hang myself in my garage. Well, guess where they found her? Hanging in her garage. How about the bankers, all the banker suicides? Wow, just a big rash of banker suicides, including one guy in Colorado that shot himself, what, 8 times in the head with a nail gun? Yeah, these things can be kept secret. Look, when we first heard about the stealth fighter, that was in the first Gulf War, right? Well, that thing had been operational since 1983. I didn't see anything about it, did you? There's no telling what they have now that's operational. No, this outfit is very good at keeping secrets. Art Bell and crew have been trying to crack the Area 51 deal for a long time. Anybody been successful? But everybody goes back to the one caller he got. He says, Area 51. it's Area 51. They're coming to get me. And click, the phone hangs up, and he was never heard from again. Well, that's rubbish. That's just a rubbish call, you know? Anybody can do that. But when you see, I mean, just like this deal here, finally, we see, it looks like there's some Canadian spook was taking these three girls to ISIS, just walked them right through. And then, of course, the headlines are, young girls are going to fight with ISIS to become brides of ISIS fighters and all this stuff. It's absolutely easy to keep secrets, especially, look, Thomas Jefferson said something to this effect. The biggest argument against democracy is a 5-minute conversation with one of the citizens. and this is not talking down. Look, I lived in an era of like my country, a silent American. Yes, let's go to Vietnam. We'll fight those damn commies. I walked around with 1A draft card for a while. I didn't burn it. They never called me up. And as time went by, I began to think, there's something wrong with this. As time went by, I began looking at this lone assassin, Lee Oswald. You ever been up to School Book Depository? Let me tell you what, Alvin York couldn't have made a shot like that. And certainly not with that rifle. Carlos Hathcock, the greatest sniper the United States ever had before Chris Kyle, looked at that and went, I can't make that shot. And Carlos Hathcock could hit a flea in its backside at 1,000 yards with anything that didn't have a barrel that was bent. So it's nonsense. They just tell us, and they tell us, and they tell us, and we go on with our lives. Because, see, they have nothing to do all day except what they do, just like we. We don't have anything to do except what we do all day. We have our jobs, we have our families, or not, or whatever it is that we occupy our time with during the course of the day. That's what we concentrate on. But if you decide that you want to find out what the truth of the matters are, that's going to require time. And that's why I feel very privileged to be able to sit in that chair, sit on the bridge, and just have handed to me and our audience the results of no telling how many decades of real work, real research, countless thousands of hours spent in this research. And these people come on the program and they give it to us. There's not enough time in 100 lifetimes to do the work that has been presented on our program in just over a year. So if you want to know, you can know. But if you don't want to know, then don't make excuses by saying, oh, you're just trying to gin up angst and fear. You're just trying to sell something. It's like, yeah, let me tell you what, I don't need to sell it, because once you get a taste of it, this stuff sells itself. It's just like what Dr. Paul Craig Roberts said. Truth is always the enemy of the state. And it's true. And G. Edgar Griffin said, I said, would you mind doing a little liner for us? He said, not at all. And it was really cool. He said, this is G. Edward Griffin, riding with the caravan to midnight, in search of the 1% that will change the world. Now, that's what we're looking for. We're looking for the 1%. Not the 1% that's sitting on top of the wealth pile, but the 1% that'll change the world. And part of that 1% is in your audience right now. And all we want them to do is join us. I'll put in the time and the resources and the crew. All I need out of you is $5 a month. That's it. And you don't sit and listen to endless commercials. You don't do any of that. You just listen to people who have spent their lives in research, doing the work, tell you what they came up with. That's it. I think it's a pretty good deal myself, but apparently a lot of other people do too.
How does Caravan to Midnight differ from what you did at Coast to Coast AM and from other shows on the radio? How would you describe the show?
Well, I don't get text messages from the production staff telling me to pull back on this or not do that. We don't sit through endless commercials, and we say exactly what we want to. We're not going to get a call from anybody saying, you can't say that. We don't get a call from anybody saying, well, you're going to be fired. We don't get a call from anybody saying, well, we're going to go a different direction. We say Obama whenever we feel like it. We don't do it gratuitously. I don't even like speaking in the name. And just for the record, I have never said that I hated this president. I have never said that. Nor will I ever say it, because I don't. Hate is harder on the person doing the hating than the object of the hatred. What I have said is that I loathe and despise this president and his whole stinking crew. Now, I did say that, but I never used the H word, because it's just plain stupid. It's an irrational emotion. And really, I think the reason that it's harder on the one who's doing the hating than the one who's being hated is because it is so. It is like an unguided missile. Even though you think you're directing it at something, you really wind up directing it at yourself. It's an emotion that's born of frustration and, frankly, impotence. I'd rather just put hate aside and just stick with the facts. If this guy turns out to be just the greatest thing since sliced bread, I'll say so. In the meantime, I'll say that I believe he's one of the, I think maybe he is one of the best things that's ever happened to this country. Just not for the reasons that someone might think I would say that.
Explain to the audience how to listen to your show, when they can listen to it. It seems to be an issue of confusion out there. Make it easy for them. How do you listen to Caravan to Midnight?
All right. Go to our YouTube channel. Just type in John B. Wells - Caravan to Midnight. You'll find it. And just or even use your favorite search engine and go Caravan to Midnight's YouTube channel. Okay? And listen to a few samples. Then, if you decide, I want to hear the whole interview, I want to hear this stuff, just go to caravanofmidnight.com and just follow there are some big bright orange buttons there, and we'll get you hooked up. There's an archive of, we're closing in on 300 shows here, already waiting for you. New program is not broadcast, but it's cybercast at 10 o'clock p.m. Central Time every night, Monday through Friday. We start off doing four shows. We said, nah, we're doing five. So we do five, Monday through Friday, new show, 10 o'clock Central. And at around 8 o'clock, you'll see who's going to be on in a couple of hours, and that'll give you an idea. But I would submit to you that many times people say, oh, you know, that guy's coming on. I don't want to hear that guy. It's like, The interviews and conversations that we have on Caravan to Midnight are unlike interview. I really believe this, and I'm not beating my chest. I owe it all to the great one to be able to do this job at all. And it's really more than a job. It's a mission. But these conversations are unlike conversations with the very same people that you may have heard on other programs, but they're not the same conversation. I think that there is a richness and a depth. I mean, there may be a rare exception, but I can't think of one. People are relaxed. They want to be on the program. They know that they are speaking to people who want to hear them. It's not that they're bored and they just flip on a radio and then there it is. They got nothing else to do. They're at work or whatever. They just need something to kind of fill up the airspace and listen to it. And there might be some things in there that they're interested in, and maybe not, but in any case, it's good background stuff. No, the people who come on this program know that there are people waiting who want to hear what they have to say. And that's the difference. No commercials, full-length music cuts. I think music cuts are pretty good. They may not appeal to everybody, but they'll appeal to a lot of people. Some may change their minds, go, you know, I kind of like that song after all, you know. But that's it. We try to give people a rich experience. And we do our best. Like I say, if I make a mistake, next time I come on the program will be the next day or the following Monday. I'll clear it up. I try and keep those to an absolute minimum. I don't just pretend they didn't happen and go on. Try and keep it 100% all the time. It's very difficult to do that, but we try. And we try to continually improve the program. So, that's about all I can say about it. That's the difference between this and other radio programs. I don't cut people off and keep them from saying what they want to say, just because it may upset somebody. If it upsets somebody, good. That's not on me. If the guest upsets somebody, that's on them. Why did you let him say this? Because that's what he wanted to say. What am I supposed to tell him not to say it? Do you want the guest to tell you who they are and what they think, or do you not? Do you want me to censor them, or do you not? Do you want someone to censor me, or do you not? If you don't like censorship and you want to hear the straight stuff, caravanthemidnight.com. Come see us. You'll like it. I'm pretty sure you may like it. I'll put it that way.
John B. Wells, he was here by popular demand. It's been an honor. Thank you so much, John, for being a guest on the program today.
thank you so very much for having me on your program. It was a real pleasure speaking with you and your listeners. And let's reconvene soon again at a point and time of your choosing, either on your program or mine.